Well, I'm okay, but our car isn't okay. It got totaled this morning. One second. That's not right.
One second. That's not right.
One second.
There's an echo. There's an echo. I don't know what to do about the echo. That's amazing. I mean, technology is... one little wire isn't working, and so I have to do this massive workaround, and it doesn't work. Just a simple headphone set. I can't find them anymore. You can't buy them anymore. Believe it or not, it's almost impossible to believe. I finally found one, but there's a terrible buzz in it. So I have to use this digital recorder that goes through and it echoes. You know, it's just, and I can't cancel the echo out. It's just absolutely crazy how lack of the simplicity is in the world now. Lack of simplicity. Found that out today. So our car got totaled this morning. I wasn't in it, but I got a frantic call this morning. It was terrible. And fortunately, everyone's okay, sort of, but the car isn't. It's got rear-ended. It was waiting to make a left turn at a stop in a street where you're supposed to go 15 miles an hour. And some kid, teenager, like a 16-year-old in an Audi A4, just never was obviously texting, wasn't distracted driver, was not... They must have been like, looked up, oh, the car in front of me is going. Okay, now I can look down at my text. Oh, gee, the car stopped to make a turn. And so they rear-ended our car. They totaled their car and totaled our car. But that's not the interesting part. Okay, so for me, I just say, huh, wow. First, I got the news. I got this frantic call. And... caused me to almost get all queasy and it was just horrible. It sounded horrible at first, but then I just used the wow. I said, wow. And like a miracle, I calmed down. All the queasiness, all the panic went away. All the symptoms accompanying panic just vanished. Never came back. I mean, as calm as can be all day. That's the power of the technique, full stop in the wow that we have. The problem is continuity fear. The answer is wow, full stop in the wow. That's the answer. So I put it to real-life test today, and faced with the phone call that everyone like dreads. You know, I'm trapped. I can't get out. I just got in a terrible accident. And it's like, oh my, and I can't understand what they're saying. And you just think, oh my gosh, this is the worst thing ever. But totally was able to cancel it all out. But just went to the wow, wow. The answer is wow. That all that was in my mind was just wow. My nerves calmed down. Everything smoothed out. So, again, put to the test. But the thing is 2 days before, we pulled into this restaurant parking lot, and there was no parking spaces, and it was kind of a U parking lot. We went around, and as we were going around a turn, we saw someone's pulling out. They got in their car, they pulled out. So we pulled in. Well, there's this other car that was past the parking space, a couple, you know, a little bit ways down past it. Off to the side in the handicap area, and we said, oh, "What are they? Are they waiting?" But you know, they're already past this. The etiquette isn't that they get to back up when they're past some place. I don't know. I've never seen that etiquette before. But apparently, they thought that they had a right to it since they've been waiting a long time. And I guess whatever spot opened, they felt they had a right to it. That's not the etiquette that I've ever seen. Anyway, the guy came storming out of the car. He came over and he hit our car, slapped it real hard on the back. Bam! Like that. Hit our car in the back. And then cursed me out. He was so furious. And ultimately, we ended up leaving the place, saying, wow, let's get out of here and go somewhere else. So we did. Went to a really peaceful, beautiful place. Left a really chaotic place full of turmoil, actually. And so 2 days later, what happens? Bam! We get rear-ended in the car, the same place where he hit the car with his fist. Now, is that just, you know, you want to say coincidence? Well, you have to notice hindsight. Say, wait a minute. The more hindsight you have, the more you realize, say, wait a minute. It's not all coincidence in the world, is it? there's this very interesting pattern and play going on. So I'm starting to, I look at it and say, well, God's really trying to get our attention. When the guy slugged our car, I realized God's trying to get our attention. We need to leave this turmoil and go to a tried and true place we know is very peaceful, and that's what we did. So I said, God's really getting our attention in a very, very, very strong way. And then now our car just gets totaled, and that's just an extremely strong way, God getting our attention. Something hitting us from behind. You know, something oblivious to us, just coming out of nowhere. Nobody expected. It's the last place in the world you expect anyone to hit anybody. The speed limit's 15 miles an hour. And it's just nuts. So totally unexpected, boom, from behind. And then as I'm getting ready to tape this here, suddenly I look over and the light is triggered and there's this cat walking right past her. And the cat suddenly looks at me like, what is this guy doing out here in the middle of the night with the lights on, sitting on the bench? Like, whoa. So both of us kind of went, whoa, this is weird. Right. It's wow. So cats sneak up on you, totally unexpected. So you have this, God's trying to get our attention, my attention, in a really brutally strong way almost. He's just saying, like, this is so important, I have to completely wreck your car, you know, to get your attention. So I say, okay, God, what are you trying to get my attention to? Well, other stuff keeps happening. And one of these is this number 44, or 144. And 44 keeps coming up. And I remember this dream I had of this divine guru, maybe it was Buddha. And he's wearing this shirt that said 44 on it. And I said, what's going on? So this continues to crop up continuously for me. It just is amazing. Every time I look, there's 144 or 44. I went to send this, what was it, a text message. It was really important. And I happened to look at the number, text message number. What, it was real tiny. I never noticed this before. Tiny text. And it said, this was text 144. That was yesterday. And then in parentheses, 1. 144, 1. And a couple days ago, it suddenly flashed on me. I've been trying to figure out, what is this 4, 4, 4, 4, 4? It keeps going up. 4, 4. Like that. 4, 4. And recently, I had a dream with Longchenpa showed up in the dream. And he was in a golf clubhouse. And he was... It was all about golf clubs and golf and him trading in something and calling attention to something. It was so strange. And I remember the clubhouse pro coming up to me later and says, that guy is very odd. You know, he doesn't have any emotion. No emotion at all. And then I realized, yeah, he's completely calm all the time. That's the Dharma King. Totally smooth, totally smooth. No up and down emotionalism at all. So I realized I need to get back into golf. Let's focus on golf for some reason. And Ram Maharshi also gave me a very strong indication. It was amazing what happened. And so I ended up ordering a huge set of irons, which arrived Saturday, sooner than I thought. Now, what's all this have to do with anything? Well, as I'm thinking about golf and saying, well, I really have a love-hate relationship with golf. Right now, I hate it. I don't really even want to play. But I'm getting this big push. I say, okay, Dharma Kings, you know best. You know, what's going on? And suddenly it clicked in my mind. What do you say? Well, I was on a putting green yesterday practicing, and suddenly everyone goes, whoa, and this ball comes flying in towards right on the edge of the putting green. Everyone jumps out of the way, and it's like 40 yards, 50 yards off where it should be, over the green. I mean, just crazy. This completely errant shot. The marshal, the starter, say, "What? Did you see that? What happened? Wow." Nobody yelled four. You know, usually when you hit an errant shot that's going to come in and hit somebody, you yell four. Four! Four! Like that. That's what you yell. You know, you'll do it once, twice, really loud. Four! Four! And then people look up and say, "Oh my God, something's about ready to hit us." That's golf. And then it clicked at me. I said, "Oh my gosh, 4-4, 44, 4-4. I saw a license plate yesterday, and you can't believe it. It said 4, number 4, Ross, R-O-S, 4. Then 55. 55 to me is a place of safety. It's always meant a place of safety. So 4, Ross, 4, meaning look out, something's coming in, about ready to hit you. And then that was yesterday. The next morning, our car gets hit from behind, totaled. So obviously God is just on and on and on and on. Now, then I go to this place where you have to pull tickets to wait in line. I said, "I need a 44. And what did I pull? I pulled a 66. And I said, "That's not good. That's not what I wanted to pull, a 66. Wow. And so then I get out. I'm driving the car in front of me, 66 in license plate. The one to the right of me, 66. I start, suddenly 66 is just showing up everywhere. And I get this feeling, eerie feeling, like something isn't good. This is after our car got totaled. Rear-ended. I don't know if they're going to try and fix it. It's just an absolute mangle. You know, just everything is just so busted up. But they might try to just redo the whole back end of the car. I don't know. So then I realize, you know, that 4-4. I say, uh-oh. We're back to what? We're back to something not so good. And it seems like the Holy Spirit is just obsessed with this. God is obsessed. The message I keep getting are all about this catastrophe that's going to come upon the world. And I really, you know, want to get away from talking about that. I don't like talking about that at all. Because what's the use if you don't have a remedy? Then it's just torturing us, right? It's better not to know if you don't have any remedy. All you do is just be all anxious and worried and just be miserable. So I don't like talking about it. But all these indications are, you know, you need to talk about it. I said, wow. It is true that this theme continually keeps reoccurring. Intensely, and it's getting more and more and more severe. But the good news is that I've been working for so long, my whole life, to see if there's some way we can escape troubles here. And there is a way. Now, where I was born, where my parents lived when I was born, right now, if you go there, there's this huge metal sculpture. The house isn't there anymore. Got bulldozed and a park was put in. And there's this huge metal sculpture. Really big. And it's of this flaming asteroid. This asteroid with flames on it. I mean, the asteroid coming in towards Earth. Right on the spot that I was born. And it's like, I saw it and I said, oh my gosh. My whole life, I've been trying to warn people that we're going to get hit. The Earth's going to get hit. Well, about a month ago, I for some reason I looked up something on, I googled something, and I came upon this amazing website. I don't know if I bookmarked it or not, but this man had done so much research on asteroids and ancient prophecies, and he was the best I've ever seen. And he said that there's most definitely a couple of windows of time where we're likely to get hit, because something is pushing asteroids in from the asteroid belt. And this happens periodically, and these asteroids come whizzing into the inner solar system. And planets get hit. I mean, look at the moon. It's got hit many times, hasn't it? And he says that you can, there's several windows of opportunity where we're likely to get hit. And he says up till September 2017, we're in one right now, through September of 2017, he says a very strong likelihood we'll get hit. But not necessarily. If not this, then I think there's one other window of opportunity, another 10 years or 20 years later or something like that. And there was one before this that didn't happen. But we're getting a lot of reports of near-Earth asteroids coming by, getting real close to hitting the Earth. So I noticed that what he said, I said, wow, he's brilliantly researched. And I've, of course, researched this my whole life. This has been one of the major themes of my life, is trying to warn people that we're likely to get hit. So, you know, I'm very aware of this whole issue. And now I go to play golf, and this man I'm paired up with starts talking and says, you know what, I think we're going to get hit by asteroids. I'm really into this and study this. And I said, huh? He said, yeah. And so we talked about it. And then the next day, I was out on a golf course again, and suddenly this golf ball comes whizzing right past my head from so far away. No, I look around, there's nobody there, and it hits right behind me off the metal bridge. And then another one later, same thing. The symbology was just intense. So I keep getting this very intense clusters of warnings, and it's getting stronger and stronger. But again, I say, well, that's fine, but, you know, what do we do about it? You haven't given me any answers about what to do about it. However, something has arisen as to what we can do about it. Now, I have talked about in the past of a reduced intensity zone, and this keeps coming up too. People suddenly say, I was just in Arizona. I went to Arizona. I need to go to Arizona. All the time this is happening. I'm just in a store or something, and people are conversing near me, and they always bring up Arizona. And like I say, what is going on? That is so bizarre. Well, for me, Arizona stands for a reduced intensity zone. And what I believe is we can easily shift into a reduced intensity zone, actually, where there's no troubles like this. There's no asteroids hitting the world. There's no chaos. There's no turmoil at all. Speaking of turmoil, about four nights ago, I had this terrible dream. We're driving out in the countryside, and suddenly I see these two crocodile heads, severed crocodile heads, huge heads, crocodiles, and then the bodies are separate from them. And I say, wow, that's scary. This place used to have all these gigantic crocodiles. I mean, that's amazing, but they're dead now. But they're not skeletons or anything. They seem completely fresh. I say, oh, this is weird. Then suddenly I looked up in the countryside, and I saw these huge dinosaurs, Tyrannosaurus Rex type, you know, predator dinosaurs, you know, standing on 2 feet with massive jaws. And they were marauding throughout the countryside, rampaging, just wreaking havoc, chomping everyone up and to bits. And it was horrible. And suddenly the crocodile heads connected with the bodies again, and the crocodiles came alive. And I said, and then I turned to someone that was with me, and I said, you know what? I think it's time to get out of here. Let's go. And so we turned around, and we got out of there. But I remained calm. I don't seem to panic anymore. I just said, you know, it's time to get out of here. Reptilians on the rampage in this world. So you start stringing everything together that I'm going through, and the themes are just, you know, monotonous in their consistency about, you know, troubles, right? We're going to have troubles. However, reduced intensity zone, there's a way to go to a place where we're not troubled. But the great question is how? Now, this answer has come to me during the last 2 months intensive I was doing. It finally clicked in. I finally have the answer. And it came about from a lesson in A Course in Miracles. I think it was lesson 132. I loosed the world from everything I thought it was. You know, I loosed the world from everything I thought it was. And I had spontaneously come across this on my own. The work I was doing in the intensive, where I understand what the world is. I understand what the world's all about, actually, now. So the entire situation is cleared up for me. The questions have been answered, actually. And since I'm able to block panic, I can look at like a coming catastrophe and just say, okay, no problem. We can easily get free of that. I don't panic, and I understand what's going on with this world and bodies and all of that. And so what I did was I said I completely set the world free. I spoke to the world one day. I said, world, I completely set you free from pretending to cast any doubt upon me. I completely set you free from pretending to cast any doubt upon me. And that was a revelation. And then I came across this lesson from Jesus in A Course in Miracles. It's the same thing. He's saying exactly the same thing. He says, do just this. Do just this. And that's it. And again today, I did that, connected even more with that. And it's just, wow, we have the power to do this. And it's becoming very, very clear to me now that literally we can set the world free. The world is nothing but our own thoughts trying to cast doubt upon ourselves, what we are. That's all it is. It's really just light. Everything is just light. All appearances are just light. And all in its own spaciousness. And so you can say, light, I totally set you free from my desire that you cast any doubt upon me. Now, why are we trying to cast doubt on ourselves? And this is all clarified. And this may be going too fast for most of us here. But just for now, just take it on faith that the world is our attempt to cast doubt upon ourselves, and it's just a mental projection. And we're telling light, I want you to pretend that I have doubt. I have doubt. Now, it's pretty simple. When you put 101 together, it equals 2. You say, okay. What we are, then another lesson from Jesus, like 166, maybe, or there you go, 66. But somewhere there, it says, I am the Holy Son of God. He talks to us, says, you must realize you are the Holy Son of God. So you should say this, I am the Holy Son of God. I have no doubt at all. Nothing bad can happen to me. No suffering, no pain, no troubles at all. I'm perfect. I'm the Holy Son of God, which is true. We are all the Holy Son of God. But we're trying to cast doubt upon that fact. Now, why would we do that? Very simple. If we're the Holy Son of God, which we are, we're an extension of God. God extended itself. And that extension includes us as the Holy Son of God. So we are one with God. We're God in an extended format, extending itself. So if we doubt what we are, if we have doubts of what we are, if we cast doubt upon what we are, what we're really doing is casting doubt upon God. Because we're the same as God, except we're not the prime creator. So if we have a lack of certainty about what we are, what we're saying is God isn't certain God is not certain about God. So what that really means, it's our way of saying God's not certain that God's prime creator, which means that we can entertain the notion, hey, maybe we are. I don't know. We say, I'm not sure, but God's not sure either. So maybe indeed we are the prime creator and we created God. This is our little game about trying to usurp the place of God. So we do this by trying to cast doubt upon ourselves, what we really are. And the world and bodies is just our way that we've devised to cast doubt upon ourselves. We believe that we're frail, we're weak, we're vulnerable. You know, we're suffering. We've got all sorts of doubts about our survival, about, you know, what we need to do, what we should do. It's just the world on and on and on. It's just doubt, 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 doubt. I don't know what's going to happen next. And it casts shade upon us, upon our certainty, so to speak. At least it pretends to do that. So this is what the world really is. It's a way of us trying to cast doubt upon ourselves. But we're dreaming the world. God has nothing to do with the world. It's all our doing. And we're pretending that we have doubts about what we are. But we don't have to pretend that at all. We can give the world a different purpose. We say, world, pretend that we don't have any doubts. That there is no doubt about that we're perfect and certain. That reality is certain. The way that it is certain. Pretend that I'm certain that I am what I am. I'm spirit. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Then the world will do that. And Jesus tells us directly that's what will happen. Now, as I set the world free, I set everything free. Sky, you're free. Earth, you're free. Space, you're free. Atmosphere, you're free. Plants, you're free. Every aspect of light that is pretending that I have doubts about what I am. Set it all free. I set it all free. You're absolutely free, I said. In this instant, you're free. I loose you from all the attempts to bind you, to try to cast doubt upon me. And when I did that, then I realized that the world is becomes very diaphanous almost, and instead of being some hard concretized thing, it becomes very spacious. And I realized that the world can literally be like a literally appear to us as another realm, actually a beautiful realm, just like that. There's a way to shift worlds, actually. And yet the way it's done is to loose this world entirely from being a world that of doubt. So this is dawning upon me, and I saw it. I said, oh, that's easy. It's so easy. It's so easy. People don't realize how absolutely easy it is. You loose the world from all everything, all your attempts to bind the world to serving the purpose of doubt, and now the world serves the purpose of reminding you that you are perfect, reminding us that we are perfect, that we have no doubt about what we are. So that's what the world now reflects to us. But first, you have to set it free so it can do this. So the world can reflect, as the world reflects perfect certainty back to us, this wonderful certainty, that's a reduced intensity zone. Now, it may not be total perfect reflection of certainty. That might be overwhelming for us. Our continuity fear might not allow for that, but it might be a doubt might be greatly reduced. Keep in mind, this world is nothing but light. So when we set light free, light can instantly produce a world for us that reflects certainty to us instead of doubt. Instantly. And I got this feeling that light can do that easily, no problem at all. And we can just find ourselves just like, but it could be just a gentle thing too. Just somehow we just flow into this reduced intensity zone. Because the light is free, it can just act like a bridge or something, you know, just like a portal or something. This beautiful journey, we're in this beautiful, wonderful environment, and then gradually it becomes just everywhere, sort of. It's like that. Easy for light to do that. Light instantly obeys whatever we ask of it. So an entire world can arise in an instant, a universe can arise in an instant from light. We just have this delusion of time, space, process, and form because we asked light to cast doubt upon itself, really, upon us, upon itself, as if it's not what it is, as if we are not what we are. And so it's been pretending to do this, but when we set it free, it no longer has to pretend to do that. So it's free to present whatever we ask for instantly, or in a very gentle, smooth way, right? It's free to do that. So it's that really that simple. Set the light free, and then the light is free to do exactly what you need for it to do, to sidestep any particular troubles in this so-called world, this world of doubt. Now, who wants to cast doubt upon themselves so severely that they would actually desire to have some catastrophe here on this planet? Having a catastrophe on this planet would cast very severe doubt on what we are, which is invulnerable, invulnerable spirit. Nothing bad can happen to us. So it's a way of casting severe doubt upon what we are, which is really trying to cast severe doubt upon God. So, who would want that, right? Well, there must be those who really, really are super arrogant and really want to try and usurp the place of God, the prime creator. And we are told, historically, that there are some cosmological beings who are really into that. And they've become very weird, you might say, in their presentation. And they sort of feast off of doubt. They love doubt, which fear is another way of putting it. They love fear, they love doubt. And they're attracted to it. And they bring it upon themselves too. So they would go to some place and where there's going to be a catastrophe, they're attracted to that place, or they attract the catastrophe to that place, so they can feast off all the doubt. Imagine this world, 7 billion people, and a couple asteroids hit. Imagine the fear and doubt in the world at that point, right? And they're here to feast off of that, because it's an ego trip, because for them, that gives them this enormous boost of belief that God has doubt too, and that maybe they're the prime creators. The real prime creators, right? That's what it does. It's called an ego trip. Ego trips feed off of doubt. And of course, doubt gets boosted massively by catastrophe. The more people in the world, the worse, the more doubt there is. So we have 7 billion people in the world plus right now. So the world has, and all this, you know, so many people, catastrophe now would create just an astonishing amount of doubt. And that dream I have, that these massive dinosaurs rampaging throughout the land, and they were like in a frenzy. I said, what's going on with them? Well, they may have just been feeding off all this doubt. I couldn't tell exactly what they were doing, but they were just like in some giddy, frenzied state, just like going berserk. And it may have been that they were just drunk on the wine of doubt, giving them this extreme ego kick that, hey, all these humans are doubting that they're spirit, and so maybe that means that God maybe is doubting that God is God, right? Spirit being one with God, a creation of God, like God. If they doubt themselves, then that's really doubting God. So they get off on this. It's like a drug for them, an ego drug. So you put everything together like this, and you say, huh, wow. So there's too many signs. I mean, when your car gets just plowed into full speed, they never even braked at all, no braking, just plowed in and gets destroyed like that, that's a pretty strong wake-up call, isn't it? Say something... And then if you factored in with everything else, then you say, okay, wow, maybe there is some situation coming. But I'm not panicked at all. I said, I feel very confident that the world, that the light will simply present an alternative for us that just easy. Jesus said, the way you will know, Well, he said he'd return at the end of the age when there's supposed to be some terrible catastrophes here in the world and take us to a dwelling place that he's prepared for us. And he said, you'll know the way. You'll know the way. You'll know how to do it. Don't worry. I'm thinking, well, how do you... Well, the light is the way. The light just provides the way. And it's difficult to explain, but it's easier just to sort of experience this clarity when you set the world free. The whole key is to set the world free. Don't ask the world to set you free. You're the one, we're the ones that are responsible for holding this world in place in our dreams, dream imagination of the mind. So we need to set the world free. That's what has to happen. And so I've been able to do that. This is a major milestone reached. So I'll continue. You know, I can be more and more stronger permissions. I haven't had any direct feedback yet, but it's sure to come. I'm confident in it. This is what Jesus wants to get us to. He said in the Course in Miracles, lesson 132. He says there is no world. This is the key point of this course. Getting to this, you have to get to this. That's it. That's what the course is really about. Is to realize there is no world. And I've already realized that. So when I came across that, I said, wow, yeah, that's it. There is no world. It's just all pretense. Mental pretense is all it is. Trying to cast doubt upon ourselves. That's all that it is. Body's the same thing. Nature, the same thing. Nature is just an attempt to cast doubt upon what we are. It's all that it is. So if there's no world, there's no world. I've been able to, you know, get these key insights and then realize, wow, it's just, I can set what I think is a world. I can set all this pretense free. You don't need to pretend for me anymore. And everything I see, I go pass it by. I say, hey, light post, you don't need to pretend for me anymore. You're free. I've set you free. Rock, you don't need to pretend for me anymore. I've set you free. It's just light. You can be the light that, you know, that you were created to be. Okay, you've never been a rock. You've always just been light. So you don't need to keep pretending for me that you're a rock, you know, subject to time, space, process, and form, you know. So everything I see, I just set it free like this. And that's a really super powerful practice, actually. And Jesus said that, he said, this is what you have to get to, realize there is no world. And set it free. I loose the world from everything that I thought it was, the purpose that I've tried to give it. And he said, not everyone will get to this easily at all. He says, some will find this quite difficult. He said, but they will return again and try again and return again and try again. They'll have to keep working at it until they get it. So he made it very clear that this isn't so easy to get to, this recognition. But this is the one we have to get to. But I said, well, whoopee, you know, I've gotten to it. But it hasn't been easy at all. He's right. It really has been quite difficult. And yet it's so absolutely easy and simple. That this world just doesn't allow for certitude. It's totally biased against certainty. And so if you say, well, I'm certain this is it, they'll say, no, it can't be. You know, you're wrong. Keep in mind that doubt doubts that it's doubt. So uncertainty, it never becomes certain that it's uncertain. It never has true insight at all. It can't. Its purpose is to not know. So not knowing can't know that it's not knowing. It's impossible, right? So there has to be reason has to look at it and say, oh, I'm certain that this is the way it is. So this information about possible some stuff coming in. Four, look out, something's coming in. Hopefully nothing is coming in, but this information, even if nothing was coming in, shifting to another world or another place, a reduced intensity zone, where the world, your environment, let's say, reflects certitude about what you are, that light is truly light. It has never crystallized. That's what I want anyway. So I'll do that anyway at some point. You can even see this world as you're here, quote-unquote world. You can see this light, beautiful light on everything. Jesus said that's what will happen. You'll start seeing this beautiful play of light in the world. He said, it's so beautiful, I can't even describe it to you. And he promised us this will happen. So I believe him. I trust him. And so at some point this will happen for me, for sure. Because I'm comfortable with this recognition and used to blocking panic through full stop in the wow practice. So I'll be able to do that at some point. And then be able to, at some point, go to higher realms, pure lands, where it's very clear. Certainty is very, very clear. There's no doubt, you know, at all. That's coming up at some point. So even if there nothing happens in the world, still this will happen. But it's certainly a handy tool to have if there is trouble in the world. And things certainly seem to be pointing in that direction as far as really fulfilling a lot of prophecy, right, that's going on. There really is. It's pretty astonishing. So, as far as we'll know the way, I believe, yes, we will. Yes, we will. It's easy. And this will be clarified coming up, but there seems to be a massive sense of urgency. I'm getting so much urgency in my life, it's hard to even describe. It's like your house is on fire. You know, you got to just go as fast as possible now. So, we'll find out tomorrow if the car is totaled or if they're going to try and fix it. That's tough. Seeing this beautiful, beautiful car. It's just, I love that car. It's a business car, actually. It's hard to explain, but it's leased. If it's totaled, we get a new car, actually. So maybe it's better it's totaled. But in the same hand, you hate to see this. I love driving that car. It's just great. And to see that car, it's just a year old, you know, just mangled like that, just smashed and mangled. It's tough. And I'm just thinking, like the world, you know, it's tough to see the world get hit by something, right? Because, you know, this world, there's a lot of beauty in it, tinges of beauty, right? And you know, it's like, we're used to, like a car, we're used to driving it. And we don't want to see it messed up. I don't want to see it messed up. My whole life I've spent searching for beauty in the world. And I've found a lot. I found some yesterday afternoon. I watched the greatest sunset of my life. I taped it. You'll be able to see it. I have video of it. It was just so amazing. The whole scene was just so amazing. It's just, I said, wow. And I told the world, I want you to now start presenting yourself as sublime to me, just sublimely beautiful. And what happened after asking for that? I get the most beautiful sunset of my life. That's what happened. And so, and before that, the day before that, I did some of the most beautiful taping, maybe the most beautiful I've ever done in my life, of the ocean. It's just, you'll see that too. It was just absolutely stunning. I just was watching it tonight, and I did some color correcting to make it even more beautiful. And it's just, it's astonishing. It's so beautiful. And that because I have set the world free from casting any doubt upon me. Okay, and so what happens is the world then starts presenting itself to you in more and more sublime ways. So that's my future. That's what's going to happen with me. I understand it. It's very simple. But of course, then after that, you know, a car gets totaled after that beautiful sunset the very next morning. I went to sleep after watching this gorgeous video and having this experience of the sunset. And I said, wow, tomorrow's just going to be such a great day. And I got to get this frantic call, woken up out of sleep by it. I'm in a terrible accident. was like, wow, what's going on? And it's interesting because about 15 years ago, maybe 13, I was in this another gorgeous place in the desert. It was so beautiful, one of the most beautiful sublime places I've ever been. And we left there, drove out of there, and we were just like in seventh heaven. I just said, wow, this is just amazing what just happened. It's so beautiful. And then we came across this horrible accident of someone had turned over in this rocky desert, and their car rolled over, and the people got thrown out. They weren't wearing their seatbelts, and it was just the worst accident I've ever seen. And I had to deal with that situation, call 911 and stay on the scene, and it was just so traumatic. And then we ended up turning back and going back to this place that we had left, this beautiful, beautiful place. And at that point, I realized, wow, there's really turmoil coming in the world, no doubt about it. Got to prepare for it. At that point, I started really seriously preparing, you know, full-on emergency mode. So it repeats, just it repeats. I leave this extremely sublime experience. The very next morning, car gets totaled. Wow. And then I went back to tonight, looking at the tape, and it calmed me down. I said, oh my, it was so beautiful. It's so beautiful. I have this beautiful, beautiful videos for you. And it's just, I tried to put text and words in it, and it just, forget it. You know, no words, no text, no concepts, just, and no music. Music, it doesn't fit. Just listen to the natural sounds of the ocean. Just listen to it. And just feel how sublime it is, how beautiful it is, and realize, hey, this is just light. This is just a play of light. I was looking at the ocean yesterday, and I suddenly realized it's just all play of light. Everything's just a play of light, isn't it? I'm not really seeing the ocean. I'm seeing light. What we see are not things, but light being reflected off of surfaces. We're not really seeing light. In terms of thing light so much, right? It's just light that we are experiencing perceptually. It's light. It's reflected light. And Jesus says that's like frozen light. But still, we think that we're experiencing water, for instance. And I said, I'm not really experiencing water. I'm experiencing the light bouncing off of that water. In my eyes, perception. And it's so beautiful. What's beautiful? Is it the water or is it the light? It's the light that's beautiful, isn't it? I kept thinking it's the water is beautiful. No, it's the light. And so what is it that loves beautiful light? It must be us. It must be us. So, amazing time, huh? And I wish, you know, when I say, maybe, well, not maybe, the clarity will continue for me, and if this recording works, I think there was a terrible echo on it, maybe, and might be unlistenable. I hope not. But we'll see what happens next. And take these silent videos to heart. There's a purpose behind it. It's called getting ready for the sublime. Now, that golf dream I had was really something else. Longchamp himself seems to be suddenly show up as a golfer and was trading in his clubs for some other clubs, and I couldn't figure out what in the world is going on. And then the very next morning, I suddenly went out and grabbed a golf club, and I was practicing with it with my new stance. I have a stance I've been using for a while. I haven't played golf only twice in the last year and a half, but when I practice swinging the club, I have this different stance. I've had it for like a couple years, and I've just been toying with it, saying, I wonder, you know, I used it a couple times, and some player I played with was really good. He said, "Hey, you know what? That's very unorthodox, but it works great." He says, "Don't quit it." He says, "I don't care what anyone says. Stick with that swing. That works really good for you." And it does. I'm able to shoot really accurately right at the flag. And it's just really amazing. But it's so unorthodox that people look at me like, "What in the world is he doing? That is weird. That's just really weird." So I kind of don't really use it that much. and I stopped playing golf, and I said, what the heck? But so I was swinging this golf club the morning after the dream of Longchenpa in the golf clubhouse, and it's a 4-degree upright club. The lie angle is 4 degrees upright, which is for really tall people who have a very upright stance. So like someone like 6'5" with a real upright stance would use a club like that. So it's the sole of the blade hits the ground, the grass goes evenly through it. But the funny thing was, is that with my new stance, this really unorthodox stance, I'm so upright that this 4-degree upright club, 4 degrees up they call it, actually works really well for me. And I said, "Holy cow, that's interesting." And so then I'm looking for some, like, I know I'm supposed to get some new irons. And I'm looking on eBay, and I say 4 degrees up, and I come across this iron set that's 3 degrees up. I couldn't find any that's 4 degrees up. So I'm researching this set, and it looks like something that could really be indicated by that dream, actually. Because Longchenpa talks about the apex, you know, Dzogchen is the, you know, Atta Yoga or apex yoga. And the name of the irons is Apex. I said, "Wow." And it's 3 degrees up, which I said, that's probably perfect, because 4 is just a little tiny bit too much, but 3 might be perfect for me. And then I'm researching it, and the people say that these irons are just like, some of the people hit them say that the best irons ever made. That's how good they are. They're used, and they get beat up. The finish gets all beat up. But I said, I don't care. I'm not really big into how the clubs look. So the more I looked into it and researched, the more I realized that this is what I need to get. And so I finally pulled the trigger on it and spent all the rest of the money I have in the world. I got $6 left right now. And got these irons. And another thing about them is they hit the ball out of the rough extremely well. They're so thin as far as thickness. They're so thin that they float, and they're so small club head. They hit through rough really, really beautifully. That's what people have said. And I tested it out on some grass in one club, and it did go through it extremely well. And that changes your game actually totally. So it's a game-changing iron. It's a forged iron, which is hard to hit. I used to have a forged set. If you mishit it, the ball doesn't go very far. But they say that they're very forgiving because it also has a cavity back sort of built into it, so it makes it more forgiving. So long story short, it's like maybe the perfect irons for me. And I came across it the very next day after that dream of Longchenpa. He said, you need to switch irons, get new irons. And it was just extraordinary what's happened. So it's a game changer, because the problem with golf is, one of the problems is rough, which is high grass. When your ball goes into high grass, it's really hard to hit out of. And it's hard to control your ball. It's just, you know, makes your day miserable. The pros, though, can hit out of it really well. What's their secret? Well, irons like the ones I ordered, they're smaller. They're not as thick. The sole is much narrower and smaller. And somehow they glide through the grass a lot better. And these have special space grooves that are supposed to help you hit out of the rough even better. So they're like, you know, really great for that. Now what this does is enable me to, off the tee, to just hit it as hard as I can, hit as far as possible, and not worry about if it goes in the rough or not. The thing about, problem is, if you're worried about hitting out of the rough, then you're worried off the tee, you're worried, you say, I got to steer this ball, I got to get it in the fairway. And you start trying to aim your shots off the tee too much. and not try to swing too hard and try to, you know, steer the ball. And when you do that, then your game starts really falling apart. You see the pros, they just hit it as hard as they can. And if it goes in the rough, they say, no problem. I can hit it out of the rough really, really well, so it's not a problem for them. So now I can just hit it as hard as I want to and not worry about the rough. It completely changes my game. It's a game changer. So this parallels this insight about freeing the world. Freeing the world. I'm not afraid of the world anymore. I've set it free. And Jesus says the world rejoices when you set it free. And it just changes everything. It's a game changer. Total game changer. So I have this insight that's a total game changer. And then I get these golf irons that are a total game changer also. And I just feel like, wow. I don't need to worry about the rough anymore. What a great feeling, huh? What a great feeling. Because the rough had just been killing me. I just had, like, ah. Oh. And with my upright stance, you can bring the club in at such a steep angle, you know, that chops, it goes through the rough even better. You know, so the whole thing is like, it's go. Everything's go, go. Go signals everywhere about that. I don't know what the correlation is exactly, but it's there. I mean, if Longchamp is stressing it, he's trying to say, hey, look, maybe I'm going to go to a nice golf course. I don't know. And use that as a way of getting used to more and more sublime. The world is very sublime. So this is our goal. Our goal ahead of us is to get used to the world being very sublime. More and more sublime. So these videos are very sublime. The play of light, very sublime play of light. And I'm getting presented more and more with these opportunities to tape more and more sublimely and do more and more sublime, be in more and more sublime atmospheres and places. This is happening for me every day, actually. And it's going to happen even more so coming up. So stick with the program. Don't change horses in midstream. We have the answer here. Whether there's a catastrophe or not, we still have the answer. So it's win-win. It's win-win. We don't have to emphasize the catastrophe if it, you know, worried about that. But we really do need to really watch the videos more than once. You know, in editing them, I go watch them quite a few times, which is great. You know, if I first color, first I watch it, and then I color correct it, and then I look to see if put music on it or text on it, and then editing it together, and so all these different steps. I may watch it 5, 6, 7, 8 times before I even post it online. It's possible, right? And sometimes even more. So I've already watched it a lot, but it should be a habit that you every day you should be watching something very sublime that has this Dharma King feel to it. It doesn't emphasize bodies, okay? It emphasizes just the play of light in some way, something very beautiful. So you have to be very discriminating in what you watch right now. So I keep doing my best, and it's taken a lot for me to do this. I have to be very fit to do it. My knees hurting a lot from all the exercise I did to do this. But my core is very strong. I'm able to do what I did. There's a lot of sublime content that I have that you can, you know, watch if, you know, you watch it. Watching it just once every 2 minutes or so, that's not going to do a whole lot of good, actually. We need to really feel comfortable. Like if you go onto like a putting green, which I did yesterday, stay on it for a while. I stayed on it for 2 hours actually putting, and I really started dialing it in, and I got really comfortable on it. Don't just make a couple putts for a couple minutes and then leave. That's just actually going to make things worse. You feel discouraged. You have to hang in there, and you have to spend some time at it. Familiarity requires time, effort in terms of sticking with it until it feels familiar, like, oh, I feel comfortable here. That's the whole point of it. So it's a discipline. It's not easy for me to do it. I have to watch the videos, and it's like, wow, because there's no storyline. really. It's just sublime, so sublime, but no storyline, really. That's how it is when you free the world. It's just all sublime, and whatever you want to experience, it's just this flow of glory. We're not people following some story, evolving. We're not that at all. That's not reality at all. Reality is just endless glory. Endless gentle glory, actually. And I come across other people's videos, Tom Jennings' videos of slow motion waves and surfers and stuff. I came across it a couple days ago. It just blew my mind. It was just gorgeous. It's on Vimeo, I think. Yeah, Vimeo. And wow. Wow, I've never seen anything like it. So I keep coming across more and more sublime content in my life, making it available to others also. The insights I have are just, you know, off the charts. But the warnings about something coming are also off the charts, unfortunately. And biblical prophecy seems to be being fulfilled, like with the new president. The one before, now this one. And, you know, roaring like a lion. A wonder worker in terms of prosperity. You know, all this stuff. You know, hey, it could very well all come true, and you know, Revelation says that saw this like something being cast down, like a mountain, a flaming mountain being cast into the ocean. Well, that's an asteroid coming and hitting the ocean, which is what I've been warned about. A couple of them actually hitting. It's in right in Revelation. It turned the ocean to blood, and what was like a third of all creatures in the ocean died, something like that. I mean, that's an asteroid hitting the ocean. That's in Revelation. So there's all sorts of woes supposed to come upon the world now. And it could happen. But also, keep in mind that Jesus said, no problem. I'll come back and I'll take you to this other world that I prepared for you. That is just gorgeous, you know, that reflects certainty to us. That we're certainly perfect and beautiful and invincible and invulnerable and loving and glorious and, you know, eternal. It reflects that to us. And that's what he said. His parting words was, that's where I'm going. I'm going to prepare a place for you. Don't be worried. And at the end of the age, I'll come back and take you, the ones that want to go, I'll take you to a place to dwell there with me. That's what he said. And parting words are very important, right? Those are the parting words of Jesus. So he's back. You know, he's getting things ready because he came back in, what was it, late April of 2:15, actually. He announced, I'm back. So he's preparing. He's getting us ready in some way. But the way that we're getting ready is quite kind of like unexpected. Like, wow, we need to have the spiritual technology of setting the world free. And we just do that. We just tell the world, I set you free. In your heart, you just say, fruit world, you don't need to pretend for me. You don't need to pretend to cast doubt upon me anymore. Because I know that's just my clever way of trying to doubt God. That's all it is. So that I can imagine that maybe I could be prime creator. Because God has doubt that God is prime creator. Right? That's all it is. So just recognize it. Repent. Recognize what you're doing. And just say, oh, that's silly. Because God is certain. And there's no way to compete with God. It's impossible. So, world, I set you free from all pretense of casting doubt upon me. And just keep saying that, feeling it. Say, I set the world free. All of it. And you can be specific and also general about it. Generalize it. And then spend your time watching these very sublime videos. My Facebook experience was not a good one. Because it doesn't lend itself to what we're doing here. It's you know, click, 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 click. Whereas what we're trying to do is watch videos, you know, for like half an hour, a block or an hour at a time, and really let it soak in, let it really sink in. That's the opposite of Facebook. So I post videos up there for people to watch, but are they really watching them on YouTube? Maybe not, because what they like is just a picture that they can glance at and then click on to the next one. They're mostly doing it through smartphones, and of course video uses up the batteries of smartphones, so they just like images. Facebook even says just put images up and a few words, and that's what people like, and they encourage that. And that's what Facebook is about. And it's also about a marketplace of people saying, hey, I you know, it's a marketplace of ideas. And I'm very clear about my ideas. And continuity fear is the only problem there is. Wow is the only answer there is. We need to practice that. We need to set the world free. Unloose it and unbind it from all desire that it cast out upon me, right? And that's what we need to do. We need to get to that and do it. And that's it. That's my message. It's very clear. I'm not shopping for messages or teachers at all. I'm set. I know what my teaching is very clearly. So, but most of the people who friend you, they have a message that they hope that you will like their message. That's what Facebook is. There's just everybody on there has a message, pretty much. And so that doesn't help get this message out, really, because yeah, they don't pay any attention to my message. They just want me to pay attention to their message. That's how Facebook is. Plus, it's click, 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 click. They might spend like a couple seconds on an image, and that's it. That's not going to get it done. It is not going to get it done. Keep in mind, when I'm taping these videos, I'm there live on the scene. I'm experiencing it live. It is very intense. That sunset was extremely an intense experience. It was just a mind blower. It was a big wow experience for me. Sitting on a cliff for 3 hours, and then watching the sun go across the sky, then suddenly the sunset started happening, and just like grab the camera and just, oh my gosh, this is amazing. The whole thing was amazing. So I'm in the midst of tremendous intensity. I'm not just clicking on an image in Facebook. You know, I mean, that's baby stuff. So right now I'm not doing Facebook. I may post, I don't know, videos on there saying this video is available. I may cut off comments. You know, someone just says, hey, you know, here's a picture. Here's another video of some other teacher or some other something else. Or, you know, it. I know you're supposed to share really nice content, and people do. I understand they do that. But here we're very specific about our content. It's for a very specific purpose, very sublime. No bodies. No trying to keep animals out of it. You know. Place where I was, there's dogs there. Occasionally, dogs run in the picture. It's okay. We don't emphasize them. We don't try to tape them. So no animal pictures, no people pictures, basically. If people wandering around just superficially, you get the picture. You see my videos. You realize there's no focus on bodies or people or dogs or animals at all, really. I allow birds because I ask birds to help us out. They're very sublime, and. So I do allow birds, and they have done an amazing job helping us out. Extraordinary. Sometimes I forget to thank them. It's just right on cue, they show up and do something that's quite sublime. And I'm just like, oh, here again, the birds came through. So I did ask the birds to help us. That's okay. But Facebook, you know, the content that's food, you know, humor, all this stuff, it's so sort of tabloidish in a nice way. I mean, there's a lot of nice posts. I realize that there really is nice people and nice posts, and I appreciate it. But it doesn't have the juice that we need, okay? It doesn't have escape velocity at all. It just doesn't. So it's not any slam against anyone on there or anything they do. I mean, I enjoyed it. But at some point, I realized, hey, this isn't getting the job done. And it's just going nowhere. It's not getting the job done. So, I could post it just block comments, basically. Block all comments and all posting on the page. And people can just look and decide, you know, if they want to view this video, they can. And I can try to grow the audience that way. I'm trying to grow the audience, what I was trying to do on Facebook. It didn't work. Because, you know, I'd love for more people to be aware of this. This is just, you know, it's the answer. It really is the answer. Blocking panic really is the answer. It opens up greater and greater clarity. And setting the world free is the answer. Jesus has said it clearly, directly, that realizing there is no world, setting the world free is what the goal I have for you. This is the goal. And I've been able to do it, you know, through... almost 40 years of working with Jesus and 48 years of very intense dharmic work. So it wasn't easy. And I'll do it more and more and more and more, but I get it. You know, I get it. So I get what needs to be done. I get what needs to be done. We have to get used to light reflecting more and more beauty and just like, wow, just that is so, so beautiful. And I don't have to say anything or do anything or label it or categorize it in any way. I don't have to cast doubt upon it, right? Because what we are has no definition. So, you know, we don't need to get into defining what we're seeing so much. I try to tape in such a way that it doesn't really lead to trying to define, you know, anything. So we get out of that definitional aspect and categorizing and say, well, what am I looking at? You know, what time of day is it? What is this? All those measurements and stuff. We try to stay away from measurements and labeling and categorizing. And you know, we want to stay in our abstract mind, our abstract mind. That's very important. But I'm saying the way to be free of catastrophe is available to us. I really feel this way now. And it's very simple. You just set the world free and the world will take care of you. The light that you've set free will absolutely take care of you and will present another world to you, another experiencing that is without the turmoil and catastrophe. It absolutely will. I really feel this way. And I understand, you know, how this is possible. You don't have to do anything. You just ask it. Light, you know, now I want you to reflect certainty to me and peace and tranquility, and it will do that. It will do that. Now, the other old world, those who don't want that, they'll still be in this world of full of catastrophe with these reptilian, you know, presences, soaking up the doubt to try and empower themselves and on their, you know, ego trip of trying to be greater than God. That'll still be taking place, also. But you won't be experiencing that. We won't be experiencing that. But we'll be aware, just as Longchenpa says, the view from the top sees all lower viewpoints are also contained within the view from the top of a mountain. Whereas if you're at the bottom of the mountain or not, you know, or halfway up, you know, you can't see the top from there. You don't have this overview. Just like a large piece of luggage can put a smaller suitcase inside of it easily, right? Big suitcase can contain a smaller one. But a smaller one cannot put the bigger suitcase inside of it. Cannot. So we can be aware of those that are suffering and still help out, but we ourselves are in this place of you know, very, very calm, peaceful beauty. So that's my goal for everyone. Everyone here in this so-called world. My goal is for everyone to sidestep any troubles and get free of doubt. Stop casting doubt upon ourselves. And we're the ones doing it. The world's not doing it to us. We're doing it to ourselves. And using the world as an excuse, as if the world's doing it to us. There is no world doing anything to us. It's just a dream of mental projection, and we're doing it to ourselves, that's all. But we're trying to do it in such a way that it seems that something else is doing it to us and saying, no, you know, the world is causing me to doubt. No, we desire to doubt ourselves, and so we're using the world as an excuse to hide this fact that we're just desiring doubt in order to believe that God has doubt about God, what God is. That's what's really taking place. All right, well, it's cold out here, and I'm going to bring this in at this mark. This is enough, I guess you might say. Generally, people don't watch those sublime videos without silent videos, I call them. I don't really say much. I might put some narration on some of them. That's possible, but maybe not. They don't watch them so much, which is too bad, because that's really, I'd say, the, you know, just as helpful, if not more helpful, to just to realize this is possible for me to experience something so sublime. I mean, that's how I felt. I feel watching these videos that, you know, I haven't posted them yet, but I'm working on it. There's something else, you know. It's just wow. I say, I can see this. I can actually, little old me is experiencing this. My gosh, what am I? I must be pretty amazing to be able to experience something so beautiful like this, so abstract and so flowing, and so free, you know, free of concretization. gives you this feeling of like, hey, light is free. You know, it's not concrete. It's not crystallized, actually. Never crystallizes. So it's a super spiritual practice, and I'd say one that's very important to do. I really advise it very strongly to put great emphasis on that. Actually, this next year, I call it the year of silent pre-intensive, is to emphasize silence more. Meaning watch videos that there's just no words or text or anything. They're just natural sounds, and even those might be a little different. And get used to this silent stillness of the beautiful play of light. And feel like, hey, I can handle this. I feel okay with this. Super important, okay? And stay away from the crass sort of stuff, of the worldly stuff, of the play of this world, you know, bodies, right? The crassness of body, worldly fleshness, you know, stay away from that stuff. Really boycott it in this year. That's your intensive, the pre-intensive for 2018 would be to spend your year in this way. So I'm kicking it off with some amazing videos. And I just trust that God will continue to provide what's helpful for us, right? Yeah. And just will yourself to watch them. I said, that's something I got to do. I'm watching a lot of surf videos right now. A lot, every day. And some of those videos, a lot of them are really beautiful. You know, water. So many beautiful water shots. They do an amazing job. And, you know, Surfline and Magic Seaweed, they post new videos every day, almost. It's amazing how much content there is every day. New stuff. It's just gorgeous all around the whole world of these waves all over the world and beautiful conditions, and just, you know, showcasing how beautiful the ocean can be. And it's very sublime. And so when I have some free time, I just go there and watch videos. I watch a webcam of the day's best waves at Bonsai Pipeline. It's a live webcam, and they edit it and show just all the best waves of the day there. It's just like, wow. It's amazing. So that's another way you can spend some time. So you can find ways to stay in contact with the sublime. And you know, I just couldn't get that through on Facebook to anybody, hardly, you know. A few of us get it. But it's hard to get through on YouTube also. We're so used to the crassness of worldly entertainment that we just think we need that or something. But not right now. During this year, I'm saying this year has to be dedicated to the more sublime, silent, and the silent pre-intensive, I call it. The Dharma King silent pre-intensive for 2017. So here we go. And have faith that the spiritual technology, the way is, it's easy. The way to a reduced intensity zone, should you want to do that, it's going to be easy for us. Not a problem. Not a problem at all. Very simple, extremely simple. Just a simple decision to set the world free. That's all you really need to do. And just keep reiterating that simple decision. And clarity will grow, but you have to block the panic through your wow practice. You know, the one answer for everything is just wow. And just stay with that. And I've had these very traumatic situations happen to me recently in all sorts of different ways, and I haven't panicked at all. Had these three huge dogs almost attack me. You know, I was trapped and various stuff that's happened. When that guy got really belligerent with us, it was pretty scary. I just blocked it off with a wow. I just don't panic. My nerves just stay like nothing happened. Just stay so calm. Because I'm blocking it through using the wow. It's just, what happened? Wow happened. How do I feel? Wow is how I feel. What should I do? Wow is what I should do. What do I think about it? Wow is what I think about it. My reactions, wow, this, the answer, what's my answer? Wow. What's going on? Wow. It's just one 360 degree response to everything, one answer to everything. It's just wow. And it keeps your mind, you stop panicking. You become better and better and better at not panicking. You stay very calm. And literally, this is, you know, the practice, okay? This is it. That's all we do. is full stop in the wow. We don't do anything else. We're not shopping for any practices here. Just full stop in the wow. Okay. So I'll keep emphasizing this. So the emphasis this year is exactly what we've been doing before, except even more focused, and say, realize, stop shopping for other stuff. You know, I'm not on Facebook shopping for other stuff. I'm there to provide content for others. But they're saying, hey, look at my content. I said, and I do, and I say, well, thank you, but you know, I'm saying to people, look at my content. You know, so I'm sticking with that. Because I know it works. I know it works. And I have the Dharma Kings to back me up. So I'm not going to switch horses in midstream now. I'm going to stick with it. So just stick with it. Not a sticky wicket, but stick with it with me. Stick with it with me this year. And just do it. Just do it. Just wow it. Just wow the year. Wow what we're going to do this year. It's going to be really wowish, to say the least. How could it be any other way? What else could I do? You know, this is what I do. This is what I came here to do. So that's what I'm doing. Very simple. Okay. Well, hopefully this audio turned out okay. I'll find out pretty soon, won't I? Very great. That's it for this one.